Hey everybody, I'm Farron Cousins here with Lee Morris, and you're watching The Daily Left, your interactive source for progressive news and commentary. Thanks for joining us. Well, last night was the second presidential debate, and while most pundits agree that Barack Obama won, John McCain was still able to make some interesting points. I call them interesting because they were completely false. First off, McCain said that we have to stop sending $700 billion a year to countries that hate us for oil. According to debate fact checkers, not only are McCain's numbers way off, but the majority of oil imported into the U.S. comes from friendly nations like Mexico, Canada, and Britain. McCain also claimed that no president had raised taxes during economic trouble since Herbert Hoover. He was once again wrong. Bill Clinton raised taxes during a recession, which led to the largest economic expansion in U.S. history. McCain also claimed that Obama wanted to fine small businesses for not supplying health insurance to their employees. And once again, this was a flat-out lie. Obama's plan only rewards those who do provide insurance and does not punish those that don't. McCain also tried to tie Obama to Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, even though he has more of their lobbyists, including campaign manager Rick Davis, working for his campaign. Finally, McCain claimed that Obama voted to raise taxes 94 times. Again, another staggering number that isn't based in reality. According to factcheck.org, 23 of those votes were against tax cuts, which didn't raise taxes. 7 were in favor of measures that would have lowered taxes for many but raised them for large businesses. 11 votes, the GOP is counting, would have increased taxes on those making more than $1 million a year. 53 were on budget measures that wouldn't affect the tax code whatsoever. And 1 vote was actually counted by the GOP 17 times. After all of these lies, it's no wonder that McCain is still sliding in the polls. In other McCain campaign news today, Sarah Palin's tax returns are being reviewed by the state of Alaska because it turns out Sarah forgot to list some very important items. Palin apparently did not list the per diem payments she received since becoming Alaska governor in December 2006. As we've previously reported, she collected nearly $17,000 during that period for 312 nights spent in her Wasilla home. A typical work year for most employees is 260 days, but the governor's staff told her this week that her work year is considered 365 days because she is on call around the clock. That would mean Palin spent about 43% of last year working in Anchorage and would allow the governor to continue receiving per diem payments that aren't taxed when she stays at her home. However, according to tax officials, having so many days away from the office should raise red flags in normal cases, and that per diem money would have been considered income. Officials also say that Palin has already underpaid her taxes for this year and will be required to pay interest on the amount that she still owes. If officials determine that Palin knowingly provided false information on her returns by not including her per diem money, there's a possibility she could be facing charges for tax fraud. And also today, the voter registration offices of the Las Vegas branch of ACORN were raided yesterday by state authorities for evidence of voter fraud. ACORN has been registering low-income minorities, but the officials claim that they have been submitting multiple registration applications with made-up or duplicated names. The raid came on the heels of a 10-month investigation into the group's activities, during which time ACORN had complied 100% with any and all requests. Over the past year, ACORN has worked to help over 80,000 people in Clark County, Nevada register to vote. For the past 10 months, anytime ACORN identified a potentially fraudulent application, they turned that application into election officials and offered to provide any information they would need to pursue an investigation or prosecution of the individual. ACORN believes that the raid is a political stunt to coerce other minority voters to not register. We go now to Lee with more of today's top stories. Lee?
Thanks, Farron. Despite the passing of the $700 billion bailout, Wall Street saw yet another dark day yesterday and sank into a deeper depression. Investors initially appeared heartened but cautious following the Fed's $700 billion injection that will alleviate corporate debt and supposedly jumpstart lending in the markets. But still, the Dow Jones Industrial Average closed off more than 500 points yesterday. Federal Reserve Chairman Ben Bernanke warned that the financial crisis could prolong the difficulty the economy is facing. The problem is that investors are still fearful that financial companies will continue to face cash shortages, even with efforts in Washington to resuscitate lending. Well, the Federal Reserve and six other major central banks from around the world cut interest rates today in an attempt to prevent a growing financial crisis from becoming a global economic meltdown. The Fed reduced its rate from 2% to 1.5%. In Europe, which has also been hit hard by the financial crisis, the Bank of England cut its rate by half a point, and the European Central Bank cut its rate in half. Also responding to the crisis and slashing its rates were the central banks of China, Sweden, and Switzerland. This action by the Fed is expected to almost immediately reduce borrowing costs for U.S. bank customers whose home equity and other floating rate loans are tied to the prime interest rate. Bank of America, Wells Fargo, and other banks also cut their prime rate by half a percentage point to 4.5% after the Fed announcement as well. And finally, yesterday, a U.S. federal judge ordered the release into the U.S. of a group of Chinese Muslims once suspected of terrorism who are being held in Guantanamo Bay Prison. The U.S. government declared the 17 men to no longer be enemy combatants earlier this year, but had maintained it could continue to hold them in Guantanamo if no other country accepted them. Now, China has urged the U.S. to send the detainees home, but Washington has held off, claiming fears the men would be tortured upon return. For several years, the U.S. has attempted to persuade other countries to resettle the detainees. Only Albania has agreed to do so, offering to take five of them back in 2006. Human rights groups have been campaigning against the group's continued detention, and now a federal judge has ordered them to be released into the United States. That's all for the Daily Left for today. Feel free to post a comment or shoot us an email at info@goleft.tv. I'm Lee Morris. Thanks for watching Go Left TV, Citizens Media on the Rocks.
My friends on earmarks, I'll tell you, we're never gonna spend $3 million again to study the DNA of bears in Montana. All right, who gave the bear a press pass?